Hi, my dear students. I welcome you for the first lecture on phase change material. It is a part of thermal energy storage system. Okay, so already I believe that already you are having enough knowledge on different thermal energy storage system, which is nothing but thermal energy storage is nothing but temporary storage of heat energy for a short period. Okay. It can be achieved in three ways. Thermal energy can be achieved in thermal energy storage can be achieved in three ways. Either purely thermal, which is called purely thermal, or thermochemical. In the thermal, purely thermal, you are having two types. One is a sensible heat storage, another one is a latent heat storage. In the previous lectures, given by Professor Muthusaravanan, has given elaborate description on sensible heat storage systems. So now we are going to the latent heat storage system, which is otherwise called as a phase change material. Okay. Before going to that, so you should know what is meant by latent heat. Latent heat is nothing but it is otherwise called as a latent energy or heat of transformation, or you can call it as enthalpy of evaporation, or enthalpy of fusion is the energy released or absorbed by a body or a thermodynamic system during a constant temperature process, which is usually first order phase transition. Okay, so sensible heat is nothing but it is the energy released during the change in temperature. There will be a change in temperature, increase or decrease in the temperature, but there will be no change in the phase. But in the latent heat energy storage system, it is defined as latent heat. There are different terms for the latent heat: latent energy, heat of transformation, or enthalpy of formation. So likewise, so it is the energy released or absorbed by a body or any thermodynamic system during a constant temperature process. So it clearly defines that the temperature will be constant, but what will change? The change will be the phase. Okay, it is the first order phase transition system. What is the first order phase transition system? A system either absorbs or releases a fixed and large amount of energy per unit volume. During this process, the temperature of the system will stay constant as heat is added. Only the phase is changed. There is no change in the temperature. So it changes from solid to liquid, or liquid to solid, or liquid to vapor, or vapor to liquid. So which is the process is otherwise called as a boiling as well as a condensation. So latent heat can also be understood as the energy in hidden form. So the substances are having its energy, or you can call it as its energy possessed by the system, which is supplied or extracted to cause a change in the state of the system without changing the temperature. Temperature will not be changed, temperature will be kept constant, but there will be a change in the substance. When there is a change in the substance, state of the substance, definitely there will be absorption of the heat energy or release of the heat energy. So this the examples are latent heat of fusion. When the ice is melting, it is called latent heat of fusion. And latent heat of vaporization, when it is in the water is converted into the steam, you are giving the latent heat of vaporization. So that is a substance condensing or vaporizing at a specific temperature as well as the pressure. Generally, this latent heat is associated with the change of phase of atmospheric or ocean air. It can be achieved by vaporization, condensation, freezing or melting. Actually this latent heat storage, latent heat, the term or the concept of latent heat is very much important in the subject heat transfer. In the heat transfer you will be studying on subject boiling and condensation. The boiling and condensation, this latent heat energy is a very important parameter. So based on that only, that the boiling and condensation will be done. Because this boiling and condensation, the application of this boiling and condensation is enormous. In your daily life, that you can see the freezing of water into the ice and converting the water into a steam. So likewise, in your daily life, in your house applications. But when you go to the industrial case, especially the power generation, that you may study about condenser, evaporators. So in the refrigerator, that you can see, there will be a condenser, there will be an evaporator. This latent heat energy concept is very much applied in refrigerator also. When the heat is absorbed by the refrigerant, it will be converted to the vapor. When the heat is released, it will be converted to the liquid, that is a refrigerant. Okay. So this generally the latent heat is associated with the change of phase of atmospheric or ocean air. That is the mostly used concept or the material. That is water. Mostly it is used for water, because the water can exist in the three phases. That is the God's creature given to us. So water is a peculiar substance which is available in plenty of water, and its application is enormous. So we can say that without water we cannot live. So the life, there is no life without water. Okay. So God has given us the water as the peculiar substance for us, so, but we have to conserve it. Okay. So now, this latent heat energy storage system, it is not a new technique. It is not a new, the concept is not found, it has been found nearly to more than 260 years ago. Okay. So this term, the English term, there is a latent. Latent comes from the Latin word latens, meaning lying, hidden. So that means it has some hidden energy, as I told earlier. So this latent heat can be understood as the energy in the hidden form. So this latent, the latent means the lying hidden. There is a hidden energy. So that is a concept of law of conservation of energy. Energy, we cannot create any energy and we cannot destroy any energy. Every substance is having its own energy. What we are going to do the transformation of the energy. The term latent heat was introduced into the calorimetry, in the field of calorimetry, that you might have studied about thermodynamic calorimetry, in the year 1750 by Joseph Black. He was a British chemist. It was commissioned by producers for Scotch whisky, that is Braveries Industries, for in search of fuel and water for their distillation purpose, to study the system changes such as volume as well as the pressure when the thermodynamic system was held at constant temperature. By keeping the fuel as well as the water at a constant temperature in a thermal bath, so how it is, the phase change, how it is occurring for water as well as the fuel, that he has investigated, and he only proposed the concept of latent heat, but it is available earlier, but he proposed, that is the thing. He is not inventor, he is discovered. Okay. So now I think you are very clear about what is in the latent heat. Latent heat is a hidden energy available within the substance which can be released or absorbed during a phase transition at constant temperature process. Then how can we calculate this latent heat storage system? Latent heat for a given mass of substance is calculated by Q is equal to M into R. But in the specific heat, sorry, sensual heat, that you can calculate Q is equal to M into C into delta T. M is the mass of substance, Cp is the specific heat at constant pressure, delta T is the change in temperature. In that case, sensual heat is purely a function of change in temperature because M is fixed and C is fixed. Specific heat is fixed, is considered as a constant, even though it is varying with respect to temperature, but we are considering this as a constant for our analytical problems. Only it depends on the change in temperature. It plays an important role. The change in temperature plays an important role in the sensual heat. But when you come to the latent heat, that you can see Q is equal to M into L. So it is a function of mass and the specific latent heat. Here L is called the specific latent heat. So where Q is the amount of energy released or observed during the change of the phase of the substance, which can be expressed in kilojoule or joule. If the quantity is very magnitude is very less, you can express in joule, or generally it is expressed in kilojoule. Where M is the mass, it is expressed in kilogram. L is the specific heat, specific latent heat for a particular substance. It is not a constant for all substances, but it is a constant for the particular substance. So latent heat, it can be, but for fusion as well as a vaporization, it may be varying. If it is a fusion, it will be having one constant value. If it is a subjective to vaporization, it will be having other constant values, but both are not same. So L is the specific latent heat for a particular substance, which can be expressed as kilojoule per kg. So when you multiply this latent heat with the mass, you will be getting the total latent heat for the given substance, for the given mass. So when you increase the mass, what will happen? The quantity of latent heat will be increased. Or if you use any material which are having higher latent heat, so you can increase the. There are two ways. Either increase the mass of the substance, or either increase the material, whether you can use the material having the higher specific heat, latent heat. Okay, these two plays an important role. So temperature is not, there is no question about temperature because it is taking place at the constant temperature. Okay, now the question comes, how the latent heat can be achieved? In what ways the latent heat can be achieved? This simply, the sensual heat is nothing but by heating or by cooling process, that by removing the heat that you can achieve. That is, it is called as a heating and cooling. So we are not calling a specific term for in the case of sensual heat. Here you are giving the specific term as boiling as well as a condensation. Boiling means there is a change of phase from liquid to vapor. Condensation means there is a change of phase from vapor to liquid. So you are giving some specific terms for this phase change. Likewise, freezing, melting. So these are the sublimation also example for this latent heat. Because if you take the camphor or any naphthalene balls, so what will happen? Initially, it will be the solid state, and it will be directly converted to the gas state. But for the heat energy storage system, that sublimation is not used. So we are taking only a latent heat of fusion as well as the vaporization only. So now we come to the point. The latent heat storage. How can we achieve the latent heat storage? The material which is used to achieve the latent heat storage is called as a phase change material. It is simply called as a PCM, phase change material, which is a PCM. Okay, now what is a PCM or the phase change material? It is a substance which releases or absorbs sufficient energy at phase transition to provide useful heating or cooling. We should have the ability to achieve the latent heat. That means substance which can release or absorb sufficient amount of energy during the phase transition so that it can be used for heating as well as the cooling. Okay. But this process will be taking place at constant temperature. Generally, the transition will be from one of the first two fundamental states of the matter, solid as well as the liquid. As I told earlier, this phase change material, when it comes, mostly you will be taking the solid as well as the liquid state only. Why this vapor state is not used? Because it needs large volume. It needs large volume because its volume per unit mass is very high. So we need separate system or the containers to store that. So this phase change material is most of the phase change material, in most of the phase change material, the phase transition occurs between solid and liquid. It is solid to liquid and liquid to solid. So water is a very good phase change material, but it can be used in the that is when it is converted to the steam. But problem with the steam is, as I told earlier, very large volume of container is required to store that gaseous state. So mostly this PCM concentrates on these two phase transitions only. That is solid to liquid. That is an abundantly available state. Yes, this steam, in order to convert this into the steam, we have to give a lot of energy. So that is a limitation here. But solid to liquid, liquid to solid, that can be achieved with the less heat. So energy released or absorbed by a phase transition from solid to liquid or vice versa, that means liquid to solid, the latent heat of fusion is generally much higher than the sensor heat. This is the energy release absorbed by the phase transition from solid to liquid or vice versa. The latent, that is called the heat of fusion, is generally much higher than the sensor heat. For example, if you take the ice, in order to melt the ice for 1 kg, you can apply 3.55 kilojoule, or 1 gram, you can apply 333.55 joule, but the water will rise 1 degree further with the addition of just 4.18 joule per gram. 4.18 joule per gram. That you can interpret such a way that, so it has possessed that amount of energy in the latent heat. That is 333.55. But in the sensory heat, you have to go for temperature change. For example, 33.35 degree centigrade to 100 degree centigrade, the difference is 65. 65 into 4.18 into, just to see how much heat is to give for sensitive heat. But this, it requires a lot of heat. But when you come to the latent heat, the for 1 kg of ice, we need 333.55 kilojoule. At the same time, it will be releasing that amount of energy. So water or ice is therefore a very useful phase change material and has been used to store winter cold, that is to cool buildings in summer, since at least the not a new technique since at least from the time of Archimedes Empire. So water is therefore a useful phase change material, water and ice, conversion of ice to water and water to ice. Because we need only 333.5 joule per kg to melt. Because, okay, in the PCM in our daily life, what can we see? What are the various PCM daily life? That we will see in the next slide. PCM material in the daily life, that is ice, water and steam. So in the cooking, and the refrigerator, and if you go to the if you enter into the kitchen, so these three stages of water is available. So in the refrigerator you will be having the ice, and when you come to the cooking you will be using the water. When you use in the cooker, pressure cookers, you will be getting the steam. So these three phases are available. And you can go to the wax in the general in the government offices for closing the offices as well as for sending any conference report, they will be using the wax. They will be melting and they will be fixing as this is a very good face change material. You can use the candle. Candle is a very good face change material that you can see after lighting the candle. There will be a liquid state. When the liquid state is poured on the floor, so immediately it will be converted to the solid form. It is a phase change material. The oil in the hill station, not in the in the very hot climate conditions. When you go to Kodaikanal or Ooty, the hill station like this, that you can experience that the coconut oil, which will not be in the liquid state. What will be in the actual state? It will be in the solid, that is semi-solid state. It is like a wax stage. Okay, so when you heat it lightly, so it will be converted to this liquid state. Like ghee also, generally ghee will be in the semi-solid state. When you heat the ghee, it will be converted to the liquid state. Once it is cooled, it will be coming to the semi-solid. So like the beef tallow, that is animal fats. Animal fats are a very good bio phase change material that is also being used nowadays for many research investigations. Okay, so this is in our daily life that you are seeing your the general PCMs like ice, water and steam, wax, candle, coconut oil, beef tallow, so are the animal fats. These are the phase change material in our daily life. The natural phase change material available is ice. For other things that ice is a naturally available phase change, other things that you have to produce. Even the animal fat also that you have to extract it and you have to convert into the form of use, then only it can be used. Okay, so this phase change material, I think all of you are clear about this phase change material. It is not a new one. It is already available, but the concept of what you are using may be new for you. Yes, now only that you are studying about this. So now you come to the mechanism of phase change material. How the phase change materials are, the concept of phase change material or physics of phase change material, how it is taking place. Now we just see the figure, the two figures, the left hand figures. This and the figure on the left hand side. So on the x axis you are having the energy content, y axis you are having the temperature. In the blue region you are having the sensible heat, the solid. If you heat the solid ice, you just take the ice. The ice will melt only at 0 degree centigrade. Initially it may be at minus 15 degree centigrade and you are heating till it reaches 0 degree centigrade, it will not melt. But instead of that, what will happen? It absorbs the heat energy, so it increases. There is an increase in the sensible heat of the ice. But when it reaches 0 degree, when all the it starts to melt, when all the amount of water available in the system is converted to the ice only at 0 degree centigrade. When it reaches the all the content of the water should be at 0 degree centigrade, and simultaneously it will be converted to water. So at 0 degree centigrade it will be existing in solid state as well as a liquid state. So till all the ice is converted to the liquid, what it will be in the 0 degree centigrade. Then so that is the flat line. That is the reason for flat line. So temperature remains constant. In the case, temperature remains constant, that is melting. That in the reverse it is called freezing, melting. So once it has reached that 0 degree centigrade, if you are heating again, then 0 to 1 degree centigrade, then it is called sensitivity. That is the red line. So in the middle of this graph that you can see, the melting of ice, which is taking place at constant temperature of 0 degree centigrade. So from 0 degree to 1 degree centigrade, so now it has reached the 0 degree centigrade at the end of this phase 2. Once it has reached 0 degree, if you are heating further and it are increasing to 1 degree centigrade, then it is called sensitive heat. Then the right hand side, that it clearly says that temperature, the same temperature as well as storage heat, the inclined line, first inclined line, first phase, that is a sensible heat. There is a temperature of change in the temperature, increase in the temperature, but the horizontal line shows that it is a latent heat storage, that is the temperature of phase change that remains constant. The range of control may be, so we are calling it as a constant temperature, there may be small fluctuation in the temperature, like 0.01 degrees centigrade, likewise a small fluctuation, but it can be neglected. And so after all the ice has been converted to the liquid, if you are heating, the heating process will be continuing, heating process will be continuing, and if you heat it to 0 degree to 1 degree, again the same steep follows like the initial one, that is so before the latent heat, that is also sensible heating, and after the latent heat also, that is also sensible heating. But in the first one, sensible heating taking place in the solid, second one the sensible heat taking place in the liquid. But our concentration is mostly on the in between. For this topic, our concentration is mainly on the in-between state, that is called latent heat. So now you will be very clear that latent heat process, the phase change is occurring during the constant temperature, but this process is reversible. So for example, if you are converting this ice into the water, and that is called melting. When the process is reversed, when you remove the heat, that means by keeping in the refrigerator or any freezer, when you remove the heat, the process will be coming back. It can be considered as a reversible process in the same way, and it will reach, again it will reach the solid state, that is called freezing. So first one is heating, another one is a cooling. Okay, so this mechanism is, again, I will explain with another graph. The first one, it gives the cooling effect. The second one gives the heating effect. The latent heat is stored while heating and subsequently released when cooling. The latent, when you are heating, for example, again, I will take the ice. Ice, when it is heated, it is converted to liquid. That means it has absorbed that heat energy so that the phase change occur. When the water is converted to liquid, it is called, now you are having the phase transition from liquid to ice, that will be releasing the heat energy. In the first stage, it will be absorbing the heat energy and releasing the heat energy, that is when the cooling effect is achieved in the left hand side, that is in the freezing side. And the heating effect is achieved in the right hand side, that is given in the red line. Okay, this the center block shows it is the latent heat storage, latent heat system, or latent heat concept taking place. Latent heat storage, latent heat energy storage is taking place the in between these two, but the constant temperature. In order to explain further that you can see it is a substance by application of heat in the left hand. You just look at the figure on the left hand side. You are applying the heat from the heat source, and the substance absorbs the heat energy and it is stored and it is released in the heating. It is released during the other process, that is absorbs, stores and release. The right hand side figure, that you can see that during the frozen, what happens? The heat is released. During the melting, heat is absorbed. During the melting, heat is absorbed. During the frozen, the heat is released. Okay, that is the thing that is given. Molten is as well as molten and store are given in the same color, and frozen and release are given in the same color. During the frozen, that is freezing of ice, the heat is released. During the melting, heat is stored in the water. If you take the phase change material, just initially phase change material will be in the solid state. Okay, so by application of heat, that means the temperature increases from the left side, that you can see in the circle in the left side, that you can see PCM in the solid state, it increases to other state, that is a liquid state. That means you are increasing the temperature. You are increasing the temperature to some state till it reaches its melting point, the topmost point that shows it's a melting point. Till it reaches a melting point, all substance will not melt at immediately. The melting will be starting once all the substance has reached its constant temperature, its melting temperature, its melting. Otherwise, so the melting will be taking place, that you can experience in the ice. When you take the ice and keep it in the atmosphere, whether all the ice will be converted to water immediately, it is not so. So once it has reached the 0 degree centigrade for all the cases, then only it will be releasing the heat energy so that it will be converted to water. So the same is in the PCM in the solid state. As the temperature increases, it goes to the top one, that is a red color top one circle shows that it is reaching the melting state. Once it has reached the melting state, it starts to melt. Then it comes to the PCM liquid state. PCM liquid state. And that you can see in the candle also, that all the candle will not melt at once. So what happens? Partially it is taking. Once all the substances has reached its melting, then only it starts to melt. This in the same way, the cooling and the freezing also, the same thing is taking place. In the same way it is taking place. Now it has reached the liquid state. Now you are going to cool, that means you are going to release the heat energy. Now the PCM is going to release the heat energy. Again there is a change in the decrease in the temperature. In the earlier case you are having increase in the temperature, second case you are having the decrease. You are decreasing the temperature of the PCM, then it starts to come to the point till it reaches the freezing temperature. Again the heat is released, or the temperature is reduced, or cooling effect is given. So once it has reached the freezing temperature, it starts to freeze, that is comes to the solid state. Once all the substances, all the quantity of that PCM has achieved its freezing temperature, then only it will come to its solid state. So this process will be taking place. It is a cycle, that is called thermal cycle. We will call it as a thermal cycling. PCM, it is subjected to the thermal cycling. Okay, this is called thermal cycling. It starts from the liquid solid state, it goes to the melting temperature, then it goes to the liquid state, then from the liquid state it comes to the freezing temperature, then it comes to the solid state. So this process will be taking place, which is called as a thermal cycle, that is called charging and discharging. The first top half circle of this figure shows it is a charging process. The bottom half circle shows it is a discharging process. So during the daytime, for example, we just take solar energy. When you keep the facing material during the daytime, what will happen? It will be, when it is subjected to the ambient temperature, the melting point of this phase change material is equal to nearly the ambient temperature or the maximum temperature that a day can occur, it will be converted to the liquid state during the daytime. But when it comes to the night time, what will happen? It should release that heat energy so that it will be converted to the PCM. So that is why PCM is mostly used for solar energy applications. Okay, now with a simple example that you might have studied in the thermodynamics, that is a pure substance. It is called, what is a pure substance? Because it can exist in its, there is no change in the chemical composition. The water always, it will be the H2O. Even it can be a liquid state or solid state or a vapor state, it will be, that is what is called as a pure substance. So in the conversion of ice to steam, that we have studied in the thermodynamics, that is in the topic pure substance, what happens? The volume to temperature. So first you are heating that the ice, then it is converted to liquid, that is called compressed liquid. It is a mixture of ice as well as the liquid. When it comes to compressed liquid, when it comes compressed liquid consists of liquid as well as a conversion of some it has the readiness to convert to a steam. So it is a compressed liquid, which is called as a compressed liquid, that is from 20 degree to 100 degree centigrade, till it reaches 100 degree, it is called compressed. When it comes to the 100 degree centigrade, it is converted to the vapor. 100 degree centigrade, it will be converted to the vapor. And once all the water has been converted to, has reached the 100 degree centigrade, it will be converted to vapor fully. Then completely the system will be in vapor state. If you are heating further, what will happen? Then the sensory heat only increases. That is a conversion from liquid to steam. That is the things that we will be using in the power generations. Power generation, the boilers as the thermal power station, that is. Okay. So I hope that you will be very clear about this phase change mechanism. Mechanism of phase change. It is taking place at the constant temperature, and there will be occurring of the phase changing. But mostly what we are concentrating, what type of phase transition we are concentrating, is solid to liquid and liquid to solid, because it requires a less volume. But when you come to the liquid to steam, it requires large volume. But the most of the PCM, what we are, apart from water, what you are having, what you are using is subjected to the phase transition from solid to liquid, liquid to solid only. We are not going to worry about this conversion of liquid to water. That is the power generation system, that is. But this, for energy storage, this is a okay. Now, if it is a good PCM material, what are the important requirements or characteristics what we need for the phase change material? You understand? important requirements or characteristics of a phase change. If you consider a material as a good PCM, a phase change material, what are the characteristics it should have? Okay, the first one is high latent heat of fusion per unit mass. That is what I told. The specific latent heat of fusion should be very high, so that a lesser amount of material can store large amount of energy. So water is if you take 1 kg of water, it can store 333.5 kg of, sorry, if you take 1 kg of ice, it can store 333.55 kilojoule of latent heat. Heat energy can be stored. So likewise, you should think about the high latent heat of fusion per unit mass. So that is second one is high specific heat. The specific heat is also a property of a material. This high specific heat that provide additional sensory heat storage effect that also avoids subcooling. So we can avoid subcooling. Okay, subcooling means if it is going below the saturated cooling temperature or condensation temperature. So we can avoid cooling temperature. You should have a high specific heat that provides additional sensory heat storage. So you can have the additional sensory heat storage apart from latent heat. And third one is high thermal conductivity, so that temperature gradient required for the charging the storage material should be small. So as far as possible, the PCM should have high thermal conductivity. Phase change material should be high. Next one is high density, so that a smaller container volume holds the material. That means less volume change due to the phase change. High density, that is the volume per unit mass will be, so the smaller container volume holds the large amount of PCM. Within a smaller container, we can store large amount of PCM. That is low volume change due to phase change material. The volume change should be low. We should not go to the higher volume change. If you are going to higher volume change, then you have to go for increasing the size of the container. It will increase the size of the system, so it becomes bulkier. And a melting point, the desired operating temperature range. So melting point should not be very high. At the same time, should not be very low. It should be in the desired operating temperature range. For your system, for example, if you are going to use the solar energy, the melting point should be in the range of the ambient temperature condition during the daytime. Then only it will be converted to melting. If you are using the material with the melting temperature of more than 100 degrees centigrade, it will not melt because it will not reach the 100 degrees centigrade during the daytime. Even if you are going more than 50 or 55 degrees also, it is very difficult for use of solar energy applications. So what may be the maximum temperature that you can achieve, that should be equivalent to the melting point temperature. And the phase change material should be non-poisonous, because it is being used for food preservations and medical applications also. So it should not be poisonous, it should not be non-flammable, so it should not catch fire easily, and it should not be non-explosive. These are the safety considerations. It should not be poisonous, it should not be flammable, it should not be explosive. So if it is having, it's a very important characteristics apart from that thermal properties, that is a physical properties that you can see, it should not be flammable, it should not be explosive, it should not be poisonous, it is very dangerous. So this should not have these properties. And no chemical decomposition, that means it should have cycling thermal stability. So if you are heating the phase change material, and the composition of this phase change material should not be decomposed. But that is why ice, as I told you earlier, ice always it will be in the form of H2O. It can be in the ice or water or steam, it should be H2O. So likewise, there are different phase change material that we are going to see in the next lecture. So no chemical decomposition. I think you will be knowing chemical decomposition, not the phase change. The components of this chemical should not be formed into other form during the melting as well as the freezing. During the melting, the chemical formula should be the same. During freezing also, the chemical formula of the PCM should be the same. And no corrosiveness in two construction materials. So if you are using for any, it is a chemical, that is a chemical property. So it should not corrode the material. It should not corrode the material where it is kept. Okay. So PCM should exhibit little or no super cooling during freezing. You should not go for super cooling. Little or no super cooling during freezing. And you should be cost wise, it should be low cost. And it should be easily available or easily it can be produced. So these are the important requirements of the phase change material. The main requirements are the first three: high latent heat, high specific heat, high thermal conductivity. But the problem associated with that we are going to discuss later. These three are important. Another one is high density. You should have the high density per unit volume. You should have higher mass content. High density. Then high density means that you can see the mercury. It is having high density because for a small volume it can have a large mass. Okay. So high density, this is also. So other properties are related to the physical properties as well as the chemical property also should be taken into account. Now, what are the advantages of this phase change materials? These phase change materials, as I told earlier, it can store higher thermal energy storage. It is having higher thermal energy storage capacity compared to sensible heat energy storage in water or any material. We can compare with the water. The phase change materials, we are going to discuss the different phase change material in the next session, but each phase change materials are having its own, are having their own advantages, but I will summarize the general advantages. So higher thermal energy storage capacity compared to the sensible heat, so it leads to smaller record storage. The quantity or the size of the system will be smaller. Only a true advantage if only small useful temperature difference can be achieved. Small temperature difference and relatively constant temperature during charging and discharging. The process will be taking place at constant temperature only. That means it recurs again. It is coming to the relatively constant temperature during charging as well as a discharging process. So we need not to go for the higher heat addition or heat supply to that system. And burner cycles for the backup generation unit, therefore their CO and HC emissions can be reduced. Most probably when you use this PCM for the energy storage, the CO, carbon monoxide and carbon hydrocarbon emissions can be reduced. But when you come to the disadvantage also, each types of PCM have their own drawbacks or limitations. But again, I will summarize there. High investment cost and peak power during discharge is limited to to its limited heat conduction in the solid state of vessel. Limited heat conduction means the low thermal conductivity. This is the main limitation determining the acceptable size for the storage system. The main limitation is low thermal conductivity of the conventional phase change meter. If you take the paraffin wax or water, it is having low thermal conductivity and limited experience with the long term operation of many thousands of charging. So if you are going for this charging and discharging process for a number of terms, long duration, for the operation long duration, but it will not be chemically stable for long duration. Then risk of, that is the loss of stability of solution and deterioration of the encapsulation material. If it is for use in the system, it should be encapsulation, that is the risk of stability of the solution. The main drawback is the conventional PCMs are having low thermal conductivity and for long-term operation, low thermal stability and higher investment cost and for loss of stability in the case of encapsulation. Okay. Now, so we should concentrate on, these are the risks. Are the challenges. So we have to concentrate on overcoming these limitations, that is to how can we increase the thermal conductivity. So we will discuss in the later, but these are the challenges available in the phase change material, thermal stability and low thermal conductivity and high cost. So these are the, and for the preparers also it requires high cost as well as a tedious process. The application of phase change materials, it can be used for cooling packs, that you can see the lot of the cooling packs, that is ice is stored in this. So in the players, mostly the players, there will be athletes or the hockey players or so they are subjected to very hot when they are playing at the summer seasons, that there will be more sorting. So what they will be doing, they will be using this these ice for the, healing the injuries or whatever. So cooling pack, it can be used as a cooling pack and in the rural areas what they will be doing in order to keep the cool drinks are substance the lower temperature, they will be using ice in the packed. So this is the cooling packs and thermoserve capsules and body cooler. So in the application that we will see in detail later, the bridge warmer, the warming the bridge and NASA dive suit and building insulation. On the building insulation also, we have concrete you are using, it is a sensitive heat material, but if you use the PCM integrated materials, PCM integrated building, so you can achieve the cooling effect also. So that is. So these are the list of the application of phase change material. It can be a good thermal energy storage for solar cooking, cold energy battery, condition of buildings such as ice storage, cooling of heat and electrical engines, cooling of food, beverages, milk products, like this, medical application, human body cooling under bulky clothing or costumes, waste heat recovery, half peak power insulation utilization, heat pump systems, passive storage, like paraffin, smoothing exothermic temperature peaks, solar power plants, spacecraft thermal system, thermal comfort in vehicles, thermal protection of electronic devices, cooling of electronic devices, thermal protection of food during transport, hotel trade or ice creams, textiles used in clothing, computer cooling, turbine inlet chilling. So these are the applications of this. So this phase change material application is vast. There are lot of application they face in materials. But if you overcome this the limitations of this phase change material, it should be a very good viable material for thermal energy storage stuff. Okay, so in the next lecture we are going to discuss about various types of PCM and how the PCM can be selected for the suitable thermal energy storage that we are going to use. Okay, so I will summarize what we discussed in this lecture. First, we discussed what is on with latent heat storage, how this latent heat storage can be achieved, that is the help of PCM, and what are the general, what is on with PCM, what are the PCM is used, in for what cases the PCM can be used, and what is the mechanism or the physics of phase change material, how this process taking place, and discuss what are the important requirements as well as the characteristics of PCM, advantages, disadvantages and applications. Okay, so next session, the types of PCM and selection of PCM, we will meet in the next session. Okay, thank you.